Well, Dodge Billingsley, who's no stranger here at the Kennedy Center, founded Combat Films in 1997 and has since documented numerous security-related topics and covered conflicts worldwide. Dodge was named as a finalist for the prestigious Rory Beck Award for Best Feature for Virgin Soldiers, which follows a squad of Marines from their base in Southern California to the end of combat operations in Baghdad. The film aired in the UK and other markets around the world. Then in 2002, he won the Rory Beck Award and the Royal Television Society Award, both for Best Feature, his film The House of War, which documented the battle for Kala Jungi Fortress in Afghanistan. And that was months later, he was also among the first to document the U.S.-led Operation Anaconda in Afghanistan, which was captured in a film called Close Combat Attack Apaches, D-Day Operation Anaconda. There he was one of only two foreigners on hand at the prison revolt that took the life of CIA agent Mike Spann. Dodge Billingsley also co-wrote and produced Immortal Fortress, a look inside Chechnya's warrior culture, which was a film that took him deep inside the dangerous war-torn breakaway region of Chechnya. Prior to that, he produced a three-part series entitled Firepower 2000 for the Discovery Channel that explored weapons and the changing nature of warfare, and he co-produced a three-part series on the Gulf War in 1991 for the History Channel. Dodge has been a regular lecturer for the U.S. Army and Navy and lectured at the New York Military Association, as well as Columbia University's Harriman Institute, King's College London, the Monterey Institute, the Center for Middle Eastern Studies at the University of Arizona, and lucky for us here at the Kennedy Center. He produced a series for us called Beyond the Border, and from time to time you may see some of our episodes playing here on the TV in the foyer. Our latest episode, The Global Car, will be coming out in 2008, which tells the story of globalization through the intricacies of global supply chain management and auto manufacturing, which will be very interesting. And the Beyond the Border series aired in 2004 of the fall and spring 2005. Dodge is a past recipient of the MacArthur Foundation Regional Security Travel Grant, and he's written extensively for defense and security-related journals, including Jane's Intelligence Review, the Journal of Electronic Defense, and the Harriman Review. He received his BA from Columbia University and an MA in War Studies from King's College Department of War Studies in London. And while he was in London, he co-founded and edited the War Studies Journal. As the title suggests today, he'll be talking about U.S. military operations in Iraq and Afghanistan. For some, I know myself, I first wasn't exactly sure what the question was on force projection or force protection. And I think it makes for a very interesting and timely topic. So please join me in welcoming Dodge Billingsley.
Thanks, Corey. And thank you for coming today. I appreciate the fact that it's the last week of class and getting ready for finals, and so I appreciate your time. Let me just dive right in here. Force projection or force protection. It's a topic I've been thinking about for some time, especially even before 9/11, back in the mid-90s when I traveled some with Chechen guerrilla groups and studied and looked at how, and interviewed many of them on how they fight. And then to be able to then be thrown into a situation where the United States was involved in war around the globe, there were some really interesting differences and some similarities. And so it got me thinking about a topic that I still haven't come to all the conclusions. I haven't reached a conclusion yet. It's something that is still kind of a work in progress for me. But with that, let me just dive in. I want to start to examine a raid that took place in World War II, the raid on Ploiest, on August 1st, 1943, under the codename Operation Tidal Wave, was launched utilizing 178 B-24 bombers. They left their airfields around Libya for Ploiest, Romania, 1,200 miles to the north. The target, 12 oil refineries, part of Nazi Germany's war machine. There was approximately 1,726 airmen involved in the mission, and the total time over target for all the aircraft was just less than 27 minutes. Still, at the raid's conclusion, 532 airmen were killed, captured, interned, or missing. Now I want to jump ahead 60 years to March 2002 in Operation Anaconda. And nearly the same amount of troops, 2,000. This time, ground forces, U.S. and coalition, both conventional and special forces, air assaulted into the Shaikot Valley in eastern Afghanistan. An hour into the assault, a member of the 3rd Special Forces Group was killed in action. The 80-plus men of Task Force Summit, half of the conventional forces, was in a severe firefight that would last an additional 18 hours. They would incur 30 wounded, but no dead. While soldiers of the other half, Task Force Rakasan, were involved in their own small skirmishes. The 5 Apache helicopters providing close air support were all basically knocked out of the fight in the first hour and 15 minutes, taking too much small arms fire for except for all for one to come back. A day later, a Navy SEAL would die. And then hours later, 6 Rangers and Air Force pararescue would die trying to rescue the Navy SEAL. Total casualties, U.S. coalition, 8, less than 50 wounded. There were, however, 7 Afghan coalition members killed, which we never hear about, which were kind of largely forgotten. And I hate to say it any other way, but they weren't us, and even though they fought alongside us. Significantly, 2 hours into the struggle, 2 hours into the fight, the ground commander, General Hagenbach, seriously considered pulling all the troops out of the valley, that the costs were just too high. So I just want to juxtapose this raid on Ploy Est with the raid, or this Operation Anaconda, and we'll back into that again. Again, I use these two examples, although one's an air raid conducted by the Air Force, and one was a ground operation, albeit with a air assault and air support component. Both operations were conducted with relatively the same number of troops, and more importantly, they illustrate our ability to project power to get our forces to the fight and our willingness, or maybe our unwillingness, to incur casualties to reach the mission objective. They also demonstrate a journey into a significant evolution in warfighting, I believe, since Ploy Est, since World War II, and that is the maturing concept of force protection. So what is force protection? Well, in the new counterinsurgency doctrine, the COIN, as it's known, which came out a couple years ago, the Army describes force protection as preventative measures taken to mitigate hostile actions against Department of Defense personnel. Oh, actually, this is not from the COIN. This is from JP 3.0. Sorry, that's an error. Joint Publication 3.0. But anyway, this is right. Preventative measures taken to mitigate hostile actions against Department of Defense personnel to include family members, resources, facilities, and critical information. So why protect the force? Why force protection? Obviously, it's driven in part by the necessity of carrying out your mission. If all your soldiers or airmen die on the way to the mission, you can't actually fight it. You have to get them to the battle for it to have a chance at being decisive. But also, there has been this expanding desire to incur no casualties. And this is the point I want to explore further. And the implications of that, of force protection, minimal casualties, and in addition to that, public expectation about going to war. I guess the real question is, have zero casualties become a condition of victory in our current warfighting environment? And if casualties are any part of the equation determining victory, can wars be fought and won in the 21st century under the accepted definitions of war? This one is from the COIN doctrine. Warfare remains a violent clash of interests between organized groups characterized by the use of force. There have been times when warfare was more like a chess game and marching around and outmaneuvering carried the day. But there's also been many more times when it actually had to spill blood to win or lose. It brings up a lot of different questions. If we leave Iraq today with what it looks like, the casualties we've taken, did we win? Maybe more importantly, if we are able to establish a stable government or help establish a stable government there, a state that's economically viable, that protects the rights of its citizens, but it costs 10,000 U.S. lives and 50 to 100,000 wounded, did we win? Was this a victory or a loss? Let's back up a little bit. History is full of examples of death, just high casualty battles. The British on the Somme in the first Battle of the Somme lost 54,000 men in 10 hours. That's 5,400 an hour. And those are staggering losses. Okinawa, Iwo Jima, D-Day, significant losses. Probably the granddaddy of them all was the Battle of Stalingrad. The near six-month battle took, they think, around 1.5 to 1.6 million casualties, 800,000 German soldiers, 750,000 Russian soldiers, and 45,000 Russian civilians. These numbers are all approximate, but they are definitely in the ballpark. None of these, that's high casualties, and this represents about 9,500 casualties a day for almost 6 months straight. Again, neither side sued for peace or wanted to change. The course in the war based on just the casualties. These battles were deemed necessary, and the casualties were deemed acceptable or tolerable. Going back to Ploiești, the raid in Ploiești, the air raid, to give the mission a chance to succeed, the bombers were ordered to fly at treetop level. However, even then, it was assumed they would lose 75 out of the 178 planes. Why? Mainly because at flying at low level, there would be more chance for accidents, fatal accidents. They would now be susceptible to ground fire. If they flew above the ground fire, that would be okay. You know, they'd have flak to worry about. But now a single rifle shot could take a plane down. Small chance, but it could do it, and it's happened before. And also parachutes would be ineffective. You can't really bail. They knew that if any crews bailed out at low altitude, they would die in the fall. The B-24 itself and the Sherman tank, for this matter, kind of represent, again, our starting point of where we've come from when we think about force protection. The B-24 is a converted cargo plane. The Sherman tank was a quick and easy tank to manufacture, but it's basically a tin can. It wasn't the best tank on the battlefield. In fact, it was probably the worst tank on the battlefield. Its weaponry could not hit and beat a German Tiger Panzer tank unless it hit it in the rear through the engine vent or maybe take off a track. And so what happened, the reason the Shermans were pushed into battle is because the U.S. manufacturing might, we could push thousands of them into the European theater quickly. So it wasn't the best tank, it was just a tank. And it was a tank we could produce in mass numbers. If you think about the Russian and German experience at Stalingrad, perhaps sending hundreds of thousands of men to their death, in a way, the manufacture of cheap, but mass manufacture of cheap and not very efficient weapon system platforms was sort of the same thing. We banked on the belief that, it's been said that once the U.S. entered the war, it was just a question of time when Germany and Japan would be beat because you could bring our economic might to bear, and sooner or later we would carry the day based on that. But again, it tells you where we've come from. If you think about these two weapon systems as opposed to the Apache helicopter, nothing's perfect, but it's loaded with redundant systems, dual hydraulics, for instance. In Afghanistan and many other places, there were times when the Apaches would be completely shot up and one of the hydraulic systems would be completely gone. Well, the other one comes in. This whole system is built to be battlefield survivable, i.e. save the crew's life. You know, obviously, again, to be able to conduct the mission, but to be battlefield survivable. And if you look at most of the weapon systems, the M1 Abram tanks, same thing. Battlefield survivability is a key component or a key ethos in the creation of this weapon system platform. Completely different mentality than 60 years ago. And again, there's a lot of other factors, but these battles equipment that I mentioned seem to indicate that warfighting is shaped not by casualty counts, but by strategic objectives. And that could be regime change today, halting a nuclear weapons program, or liberating a country, as in Kuwait, in 1990-1991. And these strategic objectives are achieved by a series of lesser or tactical objectives, such as take that bridge or liberate this city, destroy the enemy's army at this grid point. One of my favorite professors on my undergraduate courses was Warner Schilling, and he used to always say, blood and treasure. War causes a state to expend blood and treasure. Blood being its primary resource. You have no people, you have no country. So if a country goes to war, in theory, it can be assumed that all of their means to achieve its strategic objectives have been exhausted, and hence the sacrifice of life and national resources are worth it. However, but with the increased force protection and emphasis on fewer and fewer casualties, I'm not so sure if this actually stands the test of the early 21st century. Today, the operational art of warfighting is shaped by, on a strategic level, a second foreign policy objective, and on a tactical level, an underlying mission objective, and that is no casualties. For the initial lift into the Shaikot Valley during Operation Anaconda, Colonel Wyrzynski, the brigade commander who ran the show in the valley, made the call for a dawn attack over a night attack or a day attack, and there was a single reason for this: reduce the risk to the soldiers. He realized flying the CH-47, the big troop-carrying helicopters, at night across those mountains in the valley, he risked serious risk of brownout, serious risk of crashing one or two of those helicopters and losing a substantial portion of the force, 40 to 50 men in each helicopter in this case. A daylight attack against a fortified enemy, again, a slow lumbering CH-47, it's just a big flying bus with two rotors on it. very risky. So his best case scenario was this dawn attack to get there, just when there was enough light, but not so much light that the enemy would be up and around. And again, so what does it say about our expectations going from 1945 to 2007? Let's look at force projection. The ability to project the military instrument of national power from the United States or another theater in response to requirements for military operations. This is a shot of the 101st going back to Iraq in 2004. And nowadays, soldiers fly in chartered commercial air. Their equipment goes airlift, it can go sea lift, it can go numerous different ways. But we have this a tremendous ability to bring our forces, put them in harm's way anywhere in the globe and faster than ever before. But when we get there, we fight under the burden of rules of engagement and force protection guidelines. The result has been a significant reduction in casualties since previous wars. I think this, and this comes from a DOD study, and again, there's lots of ways to count the numbers, but this is more or less, I think it's more or less accurate, and it flows with some of the other studies out there. But if you look in World War I, 1 in 15 U.S. soldiers was killed or wounded in action. Didn't change much in World War II, 1 in 14. It went down, it got worse during the Korean War, and went up a little bit in Vietnam. But look at the tremendous difference between Vietnam and Gulf War I. 1 in every 760 U.S. troops was killed or wounded. And then OIF 1, basically through the end of combat operations in Iraq, April 9th, it's actually just over 1 in 1,000. The expectations have jumped so much. We can't take the casualties we took in World War II, and I'm not saying we need to, and maybe World War II wasn't the best way to fight it, and I want to explore that. There are multiple reasons that casualties have been dramatically reduced from the First and Second World Wars to today. And first off, medical achievements. Getting medical expertise to the battlefield quickly and air mobility have done more to save lives in conflict than probably we can ever really quantify. The use of the helicopter, the common use of the helicopter in every single operation to air evac soldiers out, and I see this in Afghanistan and Iraq all the time. Those things would fly overhead, you'd see the cross, you know, the white cross, the red, and they'd be zipping back and forth. Getting those wounded off the battlefield quickly has led to, it saved countless lives. Precision munitions, weapon advancement. A lot does not have to be said about this. We all know about the advent of precision-guided munitions. Nothing says more than the Gulf War 1991 when the U.S. walked in and destroyed the fourth largest army in the world at the time, on paper, the Iraq Army, in less than 100 days of aerial bombardment and ground operations. I mean, in reality, it was like 30 days of air operations and like 14 days of ground operations. With less than 100 KIA and a handful more wounded in action. And what did the public see? Bomb camera footage. It was a video game. Again, I think about this when we come to the concept of managing expectations. Pretty soon we start to expect this kind of war and very, very, very few casualties. Political considerations. I do believe that force protection matured in a war-fighting environment where in traditional war was overshadowed by the fear of escalation to the point of nuclear retaliation and eventually mutual assured destruction. So a whole bunch of limited wars, proxy wars, were fought around the globe, which necessitated that casualties must remain small, all part of keeping it a limited war, a war tolerable to the public and policymakers, one that could be fought, but not with such staggering losses that there would be calls for retribution so strong, eventually leading to all-out war and possibly crossing the nuclear threshold. That might be a bit controversial, but I really believe that. These things were born in that age, and we are still fighting. We have that legacy to deal with. I mean, after all, isn't that the oft-stated rationale for the bombing of Japan at the end of World War II with atomic weapons? And in other words, to save U.S. and even Japanese lives that would have been lost or cost in the large, massive, expected land invasion of the Japanese main islands. Not saying that's reality, but that's the perception. And it might be in the reality. We'll never know. Finally, multiple information gathering and dissemination revolutions. That's a wordy way to say the media has just gotten better. Even as recently as the first Gulf War, in fact, OIF-1, Afghanistan, 2001 and early 2000, actually all through 2002, the Achilles heel of war reporting was getting the story out. reporters could go hang out in the battlefield. But if they couldn't transmit their story, it didn't matter. You come back at the end of the 6 month and you have like a great field journal, and maybe it's a history project because it's a history in a war zone that things move fast. But nowadays with the new technologies, just since 2002, the internet bandwidth baud rates enable reporters to report and transmit the war globally in more or less real time. I mean, we think it's quick, but even in Vietnam, with it still having to cable out images through Tokyo, was often called the first TV war. And it changed the way we as a people, as a nation, experience taking casualties. In the Army, they'll say it still today, you talk to them all the time, they are still fighting the ghost of the Vietnam War in doctrinal planning. Maybe less now than they were in 2001, but it still influences decision making and force protection and how they fight. Again, what's really going on here is an effort to manage expectation. I think force protection, for me, as I've seen it in the field and I look at it, it falls into two categories: passive or benign force protection, and what I call offensive or aggressive force protection. Now, benign force protection, armored vehicles, the body armor, the helmet, V-shaped hole on your armored vehicle to be mine resistant. The South Africans made Ruivac mine resistant vehicles and sold them all over in the 1990s. They had a huge market. And I remember in Abu Dhabi, we used to go out to the test firing, and you were invited to go sit in there with your helmet and have it roll over a mine and get a concussion and walk out. And, you know, it was pretty interesting back then. But, you know, it's big business. I mean, and it's very important to protecting troops. 70% of all casualties estimated in Iraq are from IEDs, improvised explosive devices. So anything that's mine resistant can be very helpful to minimize casualties. The grate around the Stryker vehicle. The Strykers were not manufactured with this little cage around them, but they adapted them quite quickly based on the experience of the Israeli armed forces in some of their occupied territories. They find that if the grate, the slats are just far enough away and they're just thin enough, it will deflect an RPG blast, and numerous RPG blasts will hit that and not impact on the body, and they save countless lives and countless machines as well. So just a simple thing like that, like adding a cage to a Stryker, has really provided force protection. There's another shot of it rolling down the street. Now, incidentally, and I've talked about this before, unfortunately, the drivers of these Strykers were never trained with the vehicle that was now about 4 feet wider. And as they rolled down the road, they usually were ripping off all the doors of the cars in both lanes in many cases. And it got so they had to carry this notebook. It was like a journal entry thing that basically claims against the U.S. government, and they'd have to hand these out at the traffic intersections because until they could figure out how to drive down the street in them, because this is new armor for the first units added in Iraq. So it's kind of one of those interesting little stories. Also, aggressive force protection, I could think, can be put into two different categories, and this is a little more interesting. One is the weapons and doctrine designed to expand the distance to the enemy. Again, if you think about the Apache, it was the number one tank killer in the first Gulf War. And you might not have, I probably wouldn't have picked that as the number one armor killer going into the war, but its ability to get close enough yet stand off attack with a Hellfire missile enabled it to take out a lot of ground targets and be very effective with very, very little, minimal risk to the crew whatsoever. So we've expanded the distances since World War II. I mean, you think about it, the fixed bayonets. I was with the Marines in OIF-1, and on two or three occasions they did fix bayonets, but it was kind of funny, you know, that we thought we might actually have to fix bayonets, because the preferred way to attack the enemy was to sort of obliterate them at 200, 300, or 100 yards with machine gun fire, you know, and automatic weapon fire and mortars and, you know, javelins and things like this. But just in case, in urban fighting, fixed bayonets. But that is not common today. Everything is at greater distances, preferably at greater distances. Not always. But there's another form of aggressive posture taken, and that is, and I've seen this before, and I've always joked that when it gets really hairy out there, the rules of war, the rules of engagement, kind of melt away, because it's human nature to save yourself and to save your comrades. And I've never seen anything as interesting and as heroic as soldiers who would willingly lay down their life for the guy next to them. And I see it every time in the field. It's amazing, the bond of brotherhood that happens. But what happened, a lot of times, like I was with the Stryker unit, they were called down to Baghdad. We didn't follow, but I talked to some of the field grade officers after the operations there, and they were called in as a QRF, and their job was to go in and extract units under pressure. And a lot of times they would come in and fire in a 360-degree circle to be able to create a ring of fire to bring those strikers in, extract that wound or that platoon that was being caught, and get out. Sort of this aggressive sort of force protection. But there are repercussions to that. This is probably one of the most famous ones. It's actually shot by the Aegis contractor guys. Has anyone seen this video? Listen for the M4 fire. I'm surprised no one saw that video. It made kind of a stink about 18 months ago, and the guys from this, it was their country music, they posted it on the web. Again, once you're on the web, you're immortalized forever. It's not going off there. Someone's going to take it. This is on YouTube now. But the rule wasn't bad in itself. The force protection guideline, and if you see all the bumper stickers, there's bumper stickers on the striker vehicles, a lot on the tanks, and on these defense contractor cars, it says stay back 100 feet. Or you may be fired upon, and that would be in English and Arabic. But to get within 100 feet to see the bumper sticker, by that point, if you're moving fast on them and they're in traffic and they slow down, they're going to shoot you because they don't want any fast-moving cars to approach them. If you think about the Blackwater group that was the four that were ambushed in Fallujah, you know, they were rolled right up on and then just opened up with, you know, automatic fire from the cars next to them. So they're sort of trapped in. So there's this force protection guideline about keeping these vehicles off your rear. It's up to the shooters, the soldiers or the contractor's discretion. But in a lot of cases, there's a lot of video like this. And they never stop. They keep going. You know, when I was in Afghanistan, we used to drive over the sidewalks really fast. And there was an article in the New York Times about 6 months ago, and I was trying to find it. I couldn't find it. It talked about the number of pedestrian fatalities due to coalition and ISAF forces running over them in Kabul, because in being concerned about IEDs, you just drive fast. It's like offensive driving every time you enter the street. I know on the Jalalabad Road between the airport and the Camp Phoenix, man, it's a double lane with a medium. We drove on the medium on the sidewalk, and either side, whatever side was open, you never stop because there's a greater fear of being hit by an IED. This sort of aggressive force protection. In reality, though, the effort to minimize these casualties, it usually leads to inaction or overreaction. And I want to first talk about, has anybody here seen Black Hawk Down? Has everybody seen Black Hawk Down? Captain Steele, well, he was a colonel. He took his brigade to Iraq 2 years ago, and he doesn't talk about Somalia at all. But one of my best friends in the Army was his S1, and he told me that Captain Steele told him one day in Baghdad, he goes, you know, everything I do, everything is shaped by my experience in Mogadishu. I mean, Captain Steele, I didn't really think about it, but if you look at him when he's on a combat op, he carries 25 to 30 personal magazines on his body at all time. That's 900 rounds. He will not go into a firefight ever again and run out of ammunition, ever. I mean, 30 magazines on your personal body. I mean, just grab two big heavy crates and strapping it on. That's how he leaves the base every single day. Every one of his soldiers has to be an Eagle first responder, basically an EMT on steroids. And every week after certified, if you're in his brigade, you have to stick another soldier with an IV and run the IV, and you get stuck. So everybody's trained so they can take care of each other out there, and no one's going to run out of ammunition. totally shaped by it. He used to, I listened to him give a talk before they were leaving to every battalion, and he said, regarding warning shots, I thought it was kind of interesting. He said, the only warning shot he wanted his troops to take was the one that dropped the first insurgent, thus warning his insurgent buddies to drop their weapons or be next. That was it. Now, his staff officers defend him and say that really his intent was that those who wish to do you harm need to know that you plan on doing them more harm. And those who don't wish to do you harm, those that you need, that you're there to protect them. But in the end, you have to make that decision. And dead, I heard this a lot, dead guys don't go to prison. If you don't take the first shot and then you get shot, it's over. You have to make a decision. And it's just based on your assessment of that situation. Do you feel like your life's in, do you feel like your life's in danger? Anyway, these are really tricky situations on a tactical level. But aggressive force protection has a tendency, and General Petraeus addresses this in the COIN doctrine, to destroy goodwill. It creates hostile environment as locals side against our efforts in vendetta. If you think of a lot of the cases in Fallujah, and I brought this up in lectures past, much of the original problems in Fallujah were not because of al-Qaeda or former regime elements. They were based on an incident where the 82nd Airborne fired into a crowd, and probably rightfully so, they were getting shot at substantially, but a number of civilians were killed. Great tactic of the insurgent to use crowds and stuff as shields, shoot from there, force a retaliation, you kill them, all of a sudden a whole bunch of Iraqis don't like you, which then paved the way for al-Qaeda and those guys to go in there and get the ear of the population, because gosh, the U.S. just came and wiped out a couple of, you know, some kids, some old men, some women. Doesn't work. So it's really tricky. It actually goes against the larger mission objective of winning hearts and minds. Force protection versus the other, the larger objective. Let's go back to the other side of the spectrum. Inaction. Some of these commanders hamstring themselves with their own force protection requirements as force protection erodes initiative for commanders and soldiers to take decisive action. I want to go back to Anaconda for a second. It does really appear that General Hagenbach decided 2 hours into the fight of pulling all the soldiers out of the valley. It was only after Pete Blaber, who was the Delta Force Lieutenant Colonel that was running all the AFO operations, the special ops operations in the valley, indicated that to leave the valley would be a terrible mistake and that they were going to leave their teams in and kill till there's no one left to kill, that the conventional forces commander decided to leave his troops in, pull half of them out, and bring another group in the north to march into contact. Again, there was this like hesitancy to really pull the trigger, and there's been a lot of debate and a lot of Monday morning quarterbacking, even within the Army itself, as to that operation, why they weren't any more aggressive. So it's just something to think about. I'm not here to lay blame. I think with General Hagenbach or Colonel Warzynski, they had a number of firefights going on in the valley, and from their point of situation awareness, they had to make those decisions. Was it worth it? There has to be an acceptable certain level of risk. Commander told me, you know what, we can go with all the force protection guidelines, take the right number of vehicles, the right number of weapon systems, and the right number of troops to meet the guidelines, and we go out to visit that sheik. If the enemy's dedicated enough and they do their homework, they could smoke us. He goes, that's just the way it is. But you have to get out there, because if you cannot convince them that you're not afraid to leave your base and you're not afraid to go out and meet with them, how can you convince them that you're there to protect them and make the situation better? The COIN addresses this. Oh, there's Operation Anaconda. I was going to bring this map up. That's it, and I don't know how much, if anybody knows too much about it. You see Task Force 64 there on the far right. That's the Australian Special Forces. They were supposed to block the passes in the south. Conventional forces were going to land up in the mountains. And these down here, Task Force Dagger and the Special Ops are going to roll in and squeeze the enemy into these blocking positions and try to kill or capture as much of the enemy as possible. Intel, let's put it this way. They dropped the helicopters, especially at Ginger, right on top of the enemy positions instead of above the enemy positions, and so they went into a firefight almost immediately. And the Task Force Dagger here on the north side of the well ran into opposition, and that's where the 3rd Special Forces member was killed within the opening minutes of the fight. Sorry, I should have showed that slide. But anyway, I think this is really interesting. Again, in the COIN doctrine, they acknowledge this need to get out and take the risk. I love this. I mean, it's really interesting. Movement on foot, sleeping in villages, and night patrolling all seem more dangerous than they are, and they are what ground forces are trained to do. I'll just break down. It goes, I'll just drop down. They need to see soldiers and Marines as real people rather than aliens who descended from armored boxes. driving around in an armored convoy actually degrades situational awareness and it makes it more dangerous. There's a real, I wouldn't say struggle, but there is a debate going on, and especially amongst the ground forces, as to, one, to fight the counterinsurgency. How do you fight this kind of war? And two, how do you fight it and manage expectations for casualties? Because for many soldiers and commanders, getting the troops home alive is the mission. Conditions have changed since World War II. Taking of Iwo Jima isn't enough. You need to take Iwo Jima with an acceptable loss of life. The question is, what is that acceptable loss of life? This is on our way up to Baghdad in OIF-1.
This is the fight that all the Marines have been wondering when we're going to get into it. This is the time. All right. From here on out, once we cross the Tigris, there's enemy saturated everywhere. If we use as much aggression and violence and speed meaning, slow as smooth as fast, okay, we're going to pound these guys and put a real hurting on them, and hopefully that'll start destroying their will. Okay, if not, we're just going to continue taking the fight to them, and we're going to kill them. All right? I don't want any hesitation. Civilians aren't going to be standing out in the streets, okay, until this thing's over, I'm telling you right now. A lot of these fedayeen are probably in civilian clothes. I'm sure the military are probably in their uniforms. Expect them to also be in civilian attire as well, all right? If they pose a threat to you, you kill them. Understood?
So we still gone on a pre-test, AA, and fedayeen are still in black pajamas and stuff, is that
identified? Fedayeen, as far as I know right now, are in civilian attire, all right? Again, it's a judgment call when you get up there. Everybody's got that sixth sense, all right? You can sense danger, you know when something does feel right, and then you gotta take quick action. That's what we get paid to do, is take decisive action, and you gotta take it like that. If a Marine feels threatened, he shoots. Okay? We'll sort out all the damage later. Okay? We'll sort out the detail later. But it's either your life or their life. Right now I don't value their life, I value our lives. Okay?
Commanders I've spoken to, Marines and Army, again, they say that it comes back to managing these expectations that have been sort of metastasizing for the last 60 years, especially in an insurgency, because finding that singular event or operation that is essentially or absolutely critical to victory, so critical that casualties are worth it, is hard to find. You know, think back World War II. It is a different war, and again, you could pick this whole thing apart if you want to talk about the differences between World War II and now, but think of D-Day. I mean, we knew we had to land somewhere on the continent, right? Because we had to go after Germany, you know, to reach the end objective. Think of Stalingrad. I mean, the Russians had the German army group south on the ropes. This is a time to destroy them and just to decimate army group south. It would free up the whole southern part of the Russian theater. I mean, these were decisive battles that had major outcomes for the war. In an insurgency operation, it's hard to find a decisive battle, and it's hard to know if anything you do will have a decisive outcome. It's usually a longer, slower process. So then again, how do you manage the expectation of casualties and force protection with the subsequent mission objective of, what is our mission objective in Iraq right now, in Afghanistan? A stable government, destroy the enemy forces, get the host nation armies up and running so they can protect themselves. There's a number of them. But what does that actually mean, and how do we do that? So under what conditions do our armies fight? What are the rules that govern military action? Well, rules of engagement, as are known, ROEs, they give the fighter the guidelines based on many factors, including rules of war, such as the Geneva Convention and other treaties, threat assessment, intelligence, the nature of the operation, and even location. I've got one more video to show you guys. But commanders should emphasize, that counterinsurgents must remain friendly toward the populace, and that these rules of engagement will become more restrictive as peace and stability returns. A major problem I've heard a lot, which I didn't quite understand in the beginning, was how difficult it was to fight after President Bush stood on the aircraft carrier and pronounced mission accomplished. A lot of commanders told me it was really difficult to then say, we've got a major operation, we could incur this many casualties when the global expectation was this war was winding down, when in reality, they were still just starting. And again, that was just, you know, some anecdotal information and some experiences there that I've been thinking about a lot. And again, I haven't formed my own conclusions yet, but I'm going to someday. This is an example of getting the rules of engagement, again, going into a battle. A lot of times, tactically, it comes down to just a meeting on the highway or a meeting, and it's pretty loose.
Friggin' Fedayeen, and they think there's a terrorist camp down here, too. So just a wild bunch of bad dudes. 1,000 to 3,000 of them. In our particular area, they estimate 200 to 250. Ah. All right, have they got any armor? Not that we know of. But it could be out there in the grove. What's up, the tactics that they've been employing on the roads east of here have been ambush tactics. In the column, they let a few vehicles go by, then they launch a volley of RPGs, and then they beat. Something else they've been doing, reportedly against the 3rd ID, is employing suicide bombers. And they got a number of mobility kills on Abrams this way. Guy walks up to a tank, pulls the cord, and blows himself up. And all these suicide bombers have been in civilian clothes. Hey, so when we make this attack, if somebody comes at you, if he's coming toward you in civilian clothes, grease him.
How close would you say?
Can we get up there?
I mean, driving up along there, how close to that peninsula would you say we gotta start watching out?
When can we start shooting civilians?
If they start coming up to the track, if they start walking to the track and you tell them to go away and they keep coming, then I would say you'll
be. If they're running at you, shoot them.
Well, he's talking about like not like 100 meters from this point.
Okay, good point. LAR is recon this entire route. And they say that this route down here along the Tigris River, up to the attack position, which is just right around here. They say that's absolutely freaking clear. Does that answer your question? Okay. So, any questions on the enemy situation? All right. Mixed bag of cats, 200, 250 in our area. They've been doing these hit-and-run tactics, which these groves would really support. And there have been suicide bombers on the other side of Baghdad. Okay, situation friendly. Any company is attacking.
I guess what I want to say, and the reason I bring that up, is great effort is made to distinguish civilian from the enemy and to make sure the right shots are taken. I mean, I will always disagree. It's just not willy-nilly out there. Soldiers do their very best to know who they're shooting, but they're also worried about protecting themselves, mission. They want to reach the mission objective, whatever that may be. That's just the nature of war fighting. I guess the question is, it comes to the conclusion. I know I need to wrap because there may be a couple of questions. You're probably just dying to get out of here. But I would say that the zero casualty mission, it doesn't only pervade the armed forces a bit. And I don't say pervade like it's running everything, but it's there. There's a feeling about it. I really do. There are some commanders that is the mission. But it also is media. It also pervades the media-driven population and the policymakers as well. That's created an environment where fighting wars is difficult, but at least changing how we fight. And as I think about the conclusion, I thought of a number of things. Again, this is kind of something I've been thinking about, will continue to think about in future trips down to Iraq and Afghanistan. But one thing I've often heard is that, and I believe this, is that war has, even though there's extensive media coverage, it's become disengaged from the public and the rest of the country. I hear this from soldiers all the time, that they feel like, you know, I'm out there fighting, and really no one cares, because you can still buy things in the stock market or get a house or fix up your hot rod or this and that. I mean, we aren't engaged like we were in the days of massive, massive casualties. And I'm not saying there's a direct relation, but there's got to be some relation to getting the country on a war footing versus a surgical type of conflict where casualties are low, force protection is prominent, and the country can really forget and still watch what Paris Hilton is doing on the 10 o'clock news rather than what's going on in Iraq or Afghanistan. There's not enough connection. Force protection can and has compromised actual mission objectives. We must manage the expectations. The 27-minute raid over Ploiest resulted in the same number of casualties as approximately 10 months of fighting in Iraq. Does that mean that the raid over Ploiest was stupid? Or that we should be thankful that that few casualties in Iraq? Again, I'm not making those kind of judgments. It's just something to think about. And finally, if policymakers must sell the war to the public, in a sense, it becomes counterintuitive. You might think that because of force protection, low casualties, a war would be able to be fought and tolerated. But what has really happened, I think, is that now we see the public expects no casualties, and the slightest uptick causes a rethinking. All of a sudden, we want to can't rally around the cause as we might have maybe 60 years ago, because it simply doesn't really affect most of us. And in the very least, I think we are entering a new, and again, I hate to say this, a new paradigm for fighting war, because boy, how many times has that been said? About every 5 years, every time there's a new technological or doctrinal evolution. But I think we're in the midst of one right now, maybe multiple. And with that, I will conclude, and if there's any questions or comments, I'd love to hear them. Thanks. Yes.
Record. My name is Spencer, and I'm an international relations and Russian major. My question is, in talking about the raid and the battle for Stalingrad, both sides were willing to throw in massive casualties because it was a victory worth winning for both of them. Are there any victories worth winning in Iraq that you can see that would be worth throwing 50 to 100,000 more people in?
Well, that's a, you know. Well, it could still be an insurgency war with victories worth winning. I mean, the trouble is it's hard to, you know, I think of insurgency warfare as PR campaigns in the sense that you don't know immediately if you've won or not. It takes a lot longer. So I do think the insurgency campaign, well, we have to win. I mean, we're fighting it. So in that sense, we must win it. But I just don't think there's going to be, it's like Anaconda was sort of heralded as an event that changed the war in Afghanistan. And the Army was, you know, I sat through some briefings and they still believe that it changed the war. And it did, because they said after that the enemy broke into smaller forces. I'm not sure that was a positive thing. It's a lot easier to engage the enemy as the U.S. if they're in a large formation, because our ability to kill on a quick and massive scale is amazing. I mean, there's no armed forces better than the U.S. I really believe that. Not saying to every single soldier, there's, you know, good and bad people and everything, but I think as a machine, as an institution, our capabilities are hard to match. But of course, the enemy knows that, and so we'll be fighting insurgencies probably a lot more than organized armies. Heck, who knows when we'll see the next organized army face the U.S. I don't know. Maybe it'll be Russia or France. I don't know. The Brits. I'm not sure. I didn't answer your question. But, I mean, there's always going to be tactically, there's victories every day worth winning and fighting. I mean, one of the things I think about in managing expectations, again, and I don't know, and this is a policy decision, and again, we're fighting the ghosts of Vietnam. We don't emphasize body counts at all. But I've sat through some pretty instructive PowerPoints from some different policy guys and somebody from the DIA. There have been a lot of bad guys killed, a lot, and there's names and faces to go with all of them, and, you know, there's, you know, these aren't just civilians. They just, you know, people they just throw in. I'm sure they're a bad guy. Lots and lots of these guys. I mean, victories, tactically, victories are being won every day. But victories are, you know, we're probably losing tactical operations every day, too. Strategically, I don't know where the end is on this. I do agree with General Petraeus. You have to get out. You have to patrol. You can't drive out in an armored Humvee and come crawling out looking like Cyborg guy, you know, out of a space game or something, and interact with the population because you can't even approach them. I mean, force protection, ballistic eyewear, everybody wears ballistic eyewear. I think they're trying, some commanders won't let their troops wear mirrored ballistic eyewear or too dark ballistic eyewear because they want to be able to interact with the local. And so you have your ballistic eyewear on, but you gotta be able to look these guys eye to eye and see them. You gotta talk to them as, you know, one individual to the next. And if you come out with looking a little too cool, that you're just not really approachable, you know? But you still got to protect, you know? Those things save a lot of injury. That's another example, ballistic eyewear. I should have brought that up. That didn't answer your question, I'm sorry. Anything else? But that's a very personal question, whether you think we're there to fight. I mean, I've heard some thinkers on this say that, you know, the U.S. is totally willing to take casualties, just not useless casualties or casualties for the wrong cause. But that's an everyday personal experience for everybody in this country to decide whether this conflict is worth it and any future conflict. And hey, you know, maybe in the utopian world, all these force restriction guidelines and casualty averse measures will cause, you know, governments to not go to war. I don't know. Or to think extra hard before they do, I'm not sure. Yes.
I was just wondering how much more effective you think that the Army has become in winning the hearts of the people that they're trying to protect recently, as opposed to at the beginning of the war?
Well, personally, I think that there are units that, when I break down Army's productivity in Iraq, I look at it at the brigade level. It really depends on the way the brigade commander run it. So I think it's a war run by, and I think the colonel has the most influence, and his brigade, and then his battalion commanders. There are some tremendously effective battalions and brigades and companies. And then there are some that aren't very effective. There are some that really want a war fight. I mean, you know, this is all volunteer force, and there's a substantial number, maybe they'd have to do a closed ballot, but I think a lot of people that join the Army and the Marines, they want to fight. I mean, they want the GI Bill, but there's something in them that says, gosh, I wonder what I'd be like on the battlefield, or maybe my grandfather was a soldier and he fought. Well, how would I be? And I hear this all the time from these ground fighters. And to not be able to really fight, it really kind of irks them. I mean, I hear all the time, I just wish the enemy would present themselves and we could have this fight right now. I'm tired of getting IED'd, you know, or sniped once every other day. That's the kind of stuff I think that is taxing on the soldier. It's a different type of war. And as the COIN doctrine says, as you go to stability operations where you're interacting with civilians, you have to reduce the levels of violence proportionally. One of the examples I know that when I was in Mosul last, we had counter-battery radar, which basically meant we could target the enemy's mortars or artillery, makeshift artillery, whatever, and we could then fire artillery or mortars back on them, I mean, near almost immediately. But the finding was that every time they were fired upon by an enemy system, it was on the rooftop of an apartment building or from the middle of a market. And so the commander just said, we can't risk a civilian casualty. He turned counter battery off, never allowed it. He allowed it to track, but he never allowed it to fire back, ever. And that didn't set well with some soldiers, and that's just, you know, it's tough. You want to take the fight, but the reality was if you blow up the apartment building, you probably killed way more civilians than you would have ever killed insurgents. And with the technologies they're employing now, a lot of times these devices go off, and they're nowhere in the vicinity anymore. The most success they've had, from what I understand, is they're using these little handheld UAVs, the things they can throw, like the Raven and some of the others, and they're doing tremendous jobs at going over, you know, overflying patrol routes, and they've actually been able to find a number of people planting IEDs that were intended to go off probably days or even weeks after the fact, but they're able to get those guys then at that point using this UAV coverage, and that's become a very effective weapon from what I understand. And I think it's down to the platoon level, or one platoon in each company now has those UAVs. I know that in 2004, they started, 101st Colonel Steele's unit deployed with an entire company of these UAV operators that were then parceled out to the different units. So, I don't know. There's no real easy. Yes, sir.
In World War II, and even Vietnam, they would be deployed for, well, Vietnam was like year deployments, wasn't it?
Yes.
But World War II, they were there for the duration of the war.
Right.
And now everybody's complaining about year-long deployments. What has changed?
Well, again, I think it goes back to the expectations, managing expectations. I mean, a lot of things have changed. I mean, and I won't hit them all. World War II, we saw this as this grand global effort. Well, this is a grand global effort, they say. But I mean, we, you know, and it had to be done, and it felt like the very national security. And I guess that's the same rhetoric used today, but is it believable? Because it is this global war on terror. Our security is being threatened. I think actually that's one of the problems, but I don't, because it's a counterinsurgency, man, the timelines are way out there. I mean, unfortunately, I do see soldiers out in the field that are so good at their jobs. I tell them, I go, man, I wish you could be here 5 years. I mean, I wish you could stay and your unit could stay 5 years. But no one wants to stay 5 years, and I wouldn't want to stay 5 years either. And I mean, I always have the luxury of I go in for 2 months at a time and I'm out. And I feel guilty. because they're there for 13 months, usually boots on the ground, and sometimes even longer. The reserve units have been hit kind of harder than the active. But it's managing expectations, fighting a war. You know, casualties can be thought of in another way, and being home and having families fall apart and lives fall apart for being gone for too long. In this environment, this warfighting environment, that's a very good point, is that that's an expectation that has to be managed as well. I don't think politically you can assign people up and keep them out there for 2, 3, 4 years at a time till the fight's over, especially in a fight like this. I mean, I read a really interesting article, gosh, a couple weeks ago, where they talked about this being akin to the Soviet-era Cold War, where this new battle could last 50 years. You know, that's just throwing a number out, but it could last decades. And it could be a slow burn kind of thing, that we just hunt them all over the world, and they try to, you know, strike us with terrorist tactics all over the world, and it goes on and on and on until someday maybe one runs out of steam, assuming not us. I don't know, you know, looking into the future, but I think it's hard to, politically, I don't think anybody would, I think it'd be political suicide to say you're going to send your soldiers over till the job's done. And when's that? I don't know. 2028. I don't know.
That's just a matter of public opinion shift, policy shift.
I'm not sure which one goes first, but I think it is definitely a public opinion shift, and definitely, you know, it affects policy. I mean, and again, you can't exclude the media from this at all. And I'm not, you know, I'm in the category of media, so I'm not trying to rip on my own profession, but you can't exclude it. I mean, if you took the number of casualties on D-Day or Okinawa and you were broadcasting them right back within an hour, and people were going, holy crap, I think that was so-and-so, and the 100 guys just died in that 30-second, you know, and would the will to fight those kind of decisive engagements still remain? I don't know. The world has definitely changed on so many levels that I just think war fighting is shifting the way it's being fought. Air power, I notice you're from the Air Force. I mean, it's probably the biggest single proponent of this shift in mentality is that a lot of people believe that air power can win wars. And of course, there's a big debate between the Air Force and the Army whether it can or can't. It can win the right wars. It can really sort of definitely prep the battlefield, and it can win lots of tactical objectives and operational objectives. But, you know, those planes, they never, you know, it's on a screen. So again, we're backing up, we're taking care of it, a few pilots take care of the whole thing. The war, the operation's over. I mean, how many of us really think about Kosovo? We didn't lose a single person in Kosovo. Not one. Entire operation, not one. I think there might have been some accidents, but not to hostile action. No KIA kind of or anything. A complete military operation. It still has life and no casualties. But with substantial difference, what, you know, we changed things in Kosovo. That's amazing. Haley?
For me, the difference in public opinion between World War II and this is that Hitler was going from country to country, taking over countries, occupying countries. This was a completely different kind of scenario where you had a dictator in a country doing his own thing. He wasn't going in other than in the Gulf War, yes. You know, I know that, but at the time that all of this started, so to me, that's the difference in public opinion, is that when you can see an advancement of an army that give the enemy army, that gives you a different perspective on sending your troops in and how much casualty can be borne. Where this is, I don't know, it just has a different feel about it, and it's like you say, it's insurgents. You can't see them. You don't know where they are. It's not battles that you can say, oh, we've taken this much now. It's a continual going over the same territory over and over and over.
Yeah.
So to me, for public opinion, that's where it's hard to say this is worth it.
That's a good point. I mean, you think about operations in Iraq right now, and they say that, you know, the numbers show that Iraq is getting safer, and Baghdad is getting a lot safer. But now Mosul's spiking. And so, you know, it appears like you just squash the enemy here and they just sort of come out over here. And then you put the pressure on here and they come out over here. And so it's really hard, like I say, to say, did we, you know, is lower casualties in Baghdad equal success when higher casualties start to appear in, like, Al-Najaf and Mosul? Which ultimately leads back in the, you know, gosh, I mean, I hate to even use it because everybody uses the Hearts and Minds campaign. It really is that kind of an operation. As Mao said, you know, separating the fish from the sea. Right now in Al Anbar province, the Marines have had tremendous success, but I talked to one of the staff officers there, and he says, hey, so no, we didn't do anything. What really happened was the locals finally decided that they weren't, that Al-Qaeda was cutting into their illegal oil smuggling. And they're like, screw that. So we're going to side with the Americans and wipe out this competition. We're best friends with all the guys in Al-Anbar, and the Marines, if you look at their casualty numbers, they have dove in the last year. Right now, we have common cause with the sheiks in Al-Anbar province, the Sunni sheiks. It won't always be that way. A year from now, we may not have common cause with them again, and IEDs might start picking up sniper activity. But right now, no Marines are getting killed in Al-Anbar. It's fantastic for us, but it's not. We had to find common cause. We didn't win it by killing the X number of Al-Qaeda or the X number of former regime elements or Sunni, you know, former regime elements. It just, we put on, you know, we tried to be there to support and assist them, and they finally decided that they didn't like Al-Qaeda for a completely different reason. We didn't like Al-Qaeda. But you know what? It works.